One of the most striking buildings to have been taking shape over the last nearly 140 years anywhere in the world is the Basilica y Temple de la Sagrada Familia by the Catalan architect Antoni Gaudí in Barcelona. It's a building that combines in itself not only an immediately recognizable shape and a singular architectural vision, but also stands out for the extraordinary efforts that have gone and continue to go into its realization. Construction is still underway and currently expected to take until 2026. And for the highly idiosyncratic methodology that sits at the heart of its design, which is of very specific and particular relevance to model making. Because one of the methods Gaudí employed uses the hanging chain or catenary model. Gaudí did not invent this, but he developed and perfected it over several years, and so it is now inextricably associated with him. A catenary is the curve that a chain or cable or rope describes when suspended between two points under its own weight. It is an ideal or idealized shape that has its own specific mathematical properties, and it is one that we tend to perceive as inherently aesthetic, either through cultural assimilation or quite possibly because it is one that is dictated and arrived at by the laws of physics and that to us therefore seems natural. Gaudí made extensive use of catenaries, and by hanging weights onto such chains, which in fact he mostly made of string, he could not only change the shape of these curves and elongate the arches they formed, but he was also able to quickly, easily and cheaply simulate the effect that minor adjustments in the mass and positioning of the weights had on the overall structure and therefore the look and feel of the project he was working on. And using mirrors or photographs to see what the shapes looked like when turned upside down, Gaudí achieved many of his signature designs, of which the Sagrada Familia is easily the most famous. Antoni Gaudí was born in 1852 either in Reus or possibly in Riudoms, very near Reus, in southern Catalonia, as the youngest of five children. His father, like his grandfather before him, was a coppersmith, and many biographers point to the way this craftsmanship would have influenced the young Antoni, who as a child was suffering from rheumatism and so missed school a lot, spending his time at the family's summer cottage in Riudoms, where he keenly observed nature. Later, as an increasingly famous architect, he would say, "Originality consists of going back to the origins," by which he was referring to natural shapes, patterns and constellations. While he was still in his teenage years, the family moved to Barcelona, where Gaudí then studied architecture and where he rapidly took to the urban lifestyle, acquiring the epithet of a young dandy because of his dress style, his socializing, and his frequenting of theatres and fashionable bars. All of this while at the same time developing an approach to architecture individual enough for the director of the School of Architecture, Elias Rogent, to famously declare upon Antoni Gaudí's completion of his studies, "I do not know if we have awarded this degree to a madman or to a genius. Only time will tell." Time did tell, and by our assessment today, leaves very little doubt as to where we would locate him, even though arguably there is a very fine line indeed between the two. In 1883, aged 30, Gaudí was contracted to take over as lead architect on the Sagrada Familia project from the today largely forgotten man who had started on it, a Francisco Paulo de Villar, and this became his consuming passion, to the point where he moved into the workshop on the site, dedicating the last 12 years of his life exclusively to it. Having started his adult life in Barcelona as an elegant young man, he never actually married, he had no children, and over the years transformed himself from young dandy to a social recluse who made his work his life's purpose and who devoted his passion to religion and mysticism, neglecting his personal appearance to the point where he could be mistaken for a beggar. This may have hastened his demise. On the 10th June 1926, on his way from the church where he attended Mass to the church he was in the process of building, he was knocked over by a tram. Quote, "After being struck, he lost consciousness, and nobody suspected that this dishevelled old man, who was not carrying any identity papers, was the famous architect. He was taken to the Santa Cruz Hospital, where he was later recognized by the priest of the Sagrada Familia. He was buried 2 days later in the very church, following a funeral attended by throngs of people. Most of the citizens of Barcelona came out to bid a final farewell to the most universal architect that the city had ever known." Unquote. This is how the website of Casa Batlló, another important building in Barcelona by Gaudí, describes his death. Now, when Gaudí stands at the entrance to the 20th century as a pivotal figure for model making, then the century itself, from a model making perspective, probably actually belongs to somebody who could hardly be more different, both in terms of his personality and how he approached models. Born into a family of sculptors on 31st May 1925, almost exactly a year before Gaudí's unfortunate encounter with the number 30 tram, in the German town of Sigmar, roughly equidistant from Leipzig and Dresden, not far from the Czech border, Frei Otto grew up in Berlin, where he studied architecture after the war at the University of Technology. It was during a trip to the United States that he met the architect Eero Saarinen and engineer Fred Severud, who together built the saddle roof of the 7,600-seat Dorton Arena in Raleigh, North Carolina. This turned out to be hugely influential on him, as were encounters with Frank Lloyd Wright and Mies van der Rohe. By 1957 and back in Berlin, Otto set up a studio for lightweight structures, and from the early 1960s onwards, he carried out intensive research into natural construction methods and bioecology, pursuing theoretical studies, publications, and what have been referred to as utopian visions. In 1967, he designed the German Pavilion for the Expo Montreal, the very event where Buckminster Fuller premiered his famous biosphere. And by 1972, the project he is still most readily recognized for was completed, the roof of the Olympic Stadium in Munich, which he built together with Günter Behnisch. Throughout his career, Frei Otto was interested in these lightweight, tensile structures and, having to develop his techniques in an age before CAD was widely available, he did so to some extent with models. He himself talked about developing architecture rather than about design, and it is this process-oriented approach that makes him such an influential practitioner of adaptive, integrative model making. The innovative potential in his work, you could say, rests in the great interdisciplinary way of thinking between architecture, technology, art, science, and society. Recognizing the modelness of nature, he tried to make it useful for architecture and engineering, and thus for the people using the architecture. In 2005, he was awarded the Rebar Gold Medal. But Frei Otto, even though we mainly associate him with spectacular, if elegant and simple, showpieces, actually dreamt of creating an architectural language that would benefit people generally, and the poor in particular. When he was informed, shortly before his death in 2016, that he was being awarded that year's 40th Pritzker Prize, one of the highest accolades available in architecture, he is said to have replied that winning prizes had never been his ambition in life. Quote, "I will use whatever time is left to me to keep doing what I have been doing, which is to help humanity." Unquote. Frei Otto's work has influenced contemporary architecture for well over half a century and continues to do so, not only through the structures that were realized and that can be visited and photographed today, but also through thousands of models, drawings, pictures and sketches that are now firmly part of the treasury of architecture.